It is often some of the most overlooked characters in a series that we come to find out have the most complex and incredible storylines. In most of Disney's stories, a lot of the focus is placed on the main hero or heroine and their story of self-discovery. But what I found out more often than not is the story of how the villains came to be is actually much more fascinating. Yzma is perhaps one of the most overlooked villains in the entire Disney universe, and in my opinion, one of the villains who has the most tragic of origins. I'm your host as always, K-Mac Time, and today I want to take a deeper look into the backstory of Yzma.
Pull the lever, Grunk. Roll lever!
Huh?
Why do we even have that lever?
Villains are not born, they are made. This is an all-too-familiar saying which has many variations, ones about heroes, champions, or evil in general, but they all mean the same thing. No one is born into their role in a story. Something happens to them in their lives that brings out that role in them. So why don't we start looking at Yzma's past, at least the parts that we can confirm. Now before we get into all of that, I just want to make clear that I will not be utilizing any information from Descendants, the show or the movies, where there's supposed to be a son of Yzma and an antagonist. In my opinion, Descendants, both the movie and the series, is just useless filler and designed to only appeal to next generation kids, and it's just, I don't know. I don't really have any value in that, and I don't think it's canon anyway, so we're going to go ahead and skip out on that. In The Emperor's New Groove, there is a deleted scene where Yzma puts on a musical number called Snuff Out the Light, and it is here that she sings about some instances of her past, and gives us our first lead into discovering her true backstory. So let's take a closer look and dissect some of the lyrics from the song.
There's a certain age, and the men who adored you no longer swoon. It pays to avoid the sunlit days, and live.
I love its lounge quality because it's so earther.
But the moon grows old, just like us all, and her beautiful years are done. So now she prays through endless days to take her revenge on the sun.
The first lyric that stands out to me is, quote, when a woman acquires a certain age and the men who adored her no longer swoon, it pays to avoid the sunlit days and live by the light of the kindly moon. But the moon grows old just like all of us and her beauty years are done. So now she prays the endless days to take revenge on the sun. Now, at first, we think she's obviously singing about her physical beauty and appearance, as that seems to be very important to her. And while some of that may still be true, yes, I think there's a deeper meaning to this here. The story of Emperor's New Groove was originally going to be called The Kingdom of the Sun before it was eventually renamed, and was going to feature a much different storyline than that of a llama-crazed panther-fighting story that we know it to be today. That said, we don't really know too much about that story, but we can go ahead and gather a few facts from that. First off, while we don't really ever hear what Kuzco's kingdom's actually called or named, it is referred to as the Kingdom of the Sun, so there's a tie-in to the original script there. So this is where I started thinking, is Yzma then just wanting revenge on the kingdom itself? And at first that kind of makes sense, but then I dug a little bit deeper and realized that there's a bit more of symbolism going on in the movie than I had thought previously. For example, Kuzco's crown is full of this. If you take a closer look at it, it's actually in the shape of the rising sun. And I began looking further into this to see what ancient civilizations this may have been based off of. And I actually found many resources that stated the story was based off of the Incan Empire. So then I went a little bit deeper, and I came across a term that the royal family of the Incan Empire called the Sapa Inca. Now, the Sapa Inca had all the power because he was believed to have been the son of the Incan sun god. So what if Yzma's target for her revenge was not just the kingdom itself, but mostly focused on the royal family specifically?
It's brilliant, 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 I tell you. Genius, I say.
So let's continue breaking down the song she was singing previously.
When I was a girl at my daddy's side, Papa, the royal mortician, revealed to me in secret signs the mark of a magician. And daddy was no dummy, did outrageous things with the mummy. And often the stiffs that he would drive would look better dead than they did alive.
Another line that stands out is, quote, "When I was a girl at my daddy's side, Papa, the royal mortician, revealed to me his secret signs, the trademark of a magician, and daddy was no dummy, did outrageous things with a mummy, and often the stiffs would look better than they did alive. I studied well and learned the trade. I thought my looks would never fade. If I could find the recipe to give eternal youth to me, it was always my ambition to use Papa's tuition and gain some small remission from the vagaries of time." So in this part of the song, we learn that Yzma grew up around the royal courtyards, with her father being the royal mortician. I was curious about why there was mention of a mummy. But when you look more into ancient Incan culture, I actually learned something about this. According to study.com in an article, when the Sapa Inca dies, their bodies are put through a mummification process and buried within the palace. A new palace is then built for the next Sapa Inca to live in. Going back, as a part of her description of her father, she discovered that not only did he do a mummification to the old Sapa Inca, but he was also a magician. This tells me that there was an underlying motive behind her father's actions, but this is something we'll get to in a little bit. Anyway, at the end of this section of the song, Yzma used the word vagaries, which I didn't really know what it meant, so I looked it up just because I was curious. Vagaries is a noun, and it's an unexpected or inexplicable change in a situation or someone's behavior. So I think Yzma is not referring to just a change in her looks, but a sudden situation and behavioral change that occurred earlier in her life. She seeks to utilize what she has learned from her father in order to change what has happened to her.
"He can't get rid of me that easily. Who does that ungrateful little worm think he is? Does he..." A little to the left. "Have any idea of who he's dealing with?"
Now another really interesting lyric is, quote, "Every little ray of sunshine robs me of my youth. Who to blame? Who the one who to curse? You know the only one to blame would be my enemy, the sun. Snuff out the light, claim your right to the world of eternal darkness. Snuff out the light, neophytes of a world of darkness. Supai, baby, turn the every wrinkle, soon will be gone. I could squeeze myself with glee. The promise that you made me, you have really stopped at nothing. Murder, treachery, and lying, whatever it takes to keep my looks, you can't blame a girl for trying." And it's at this point that we kind of catch a glimpse of the force that may be behind Yzma's powers. Because the song was deleted from the movie, we don't ever really get to see an opportunity to see much information about other things and elsewhere in the movie or in this series. So this kind of thing she's referring to here is called Supai. What could that possibly be? Well, according to ancientpages.com, Supai was thought to be the Incan god of death, ruler of the underworld, as well as the ruler of the race of demons. This explains Yzma's obsession with darkness, but it does not quite explain her obsession with her revenge on the royal family.
"I'll get rid of Cusco."
"The real Cusco?"
"Of course the real Cusco."
Also, while doing some further researching, I came across an article saying, quote, "According to the Incan mythology, the god Supai's underground realm was called Uku Pacha, and it was one of three realms that divided the cosmos. The two other realms are Hanan Pacha and Ke Pacha, and the three clearly resemble Catholics' beliefs in heaven, earth, and hell, a concept that is also known in various other religions." Now, this has got me thinking. The concept of the Supai, or the underground ruler of darkness and death, it kind of sounds an awful lot like they're describing Hades from Greek mythology, if I'm not mistaken. And if you remember back to the movie Hercules, it pretty much fits his character to the T. On the official Disney Wikipedia page, and as part of Yzma's description of her personality, we can get some more hints as to her past and the driving force in which she became a villain and why. It says, quote, "As the main villain of Emperor's New Groove franchise, Yzma is malicious and power-hungry. However, early in her first movie, it seems that she raised Cusco rather than his own parents, and has been an advisor and the chemist to his family for many years. It is only when Cusco abruptly decides to fire her that she turns on him, deciding to kill him, then fill the power vacuum gap with herself becoming the Empress."
How shall I do it?
Oh, I know. I'll turn him into a flea. A harmless little flea. And then I'll put that flea in a box. And then I'll put that box inside of another box. And then I'll mail that box to myself. And when it arrives, I'll smash it with a hammer!
Now, in the Incan Empire, like so many others of its time, it was unheard of for a woman to rule the kingdom. Traditionally, the Sapa Inca would name a successor out of his sometimes up to 100 sons. However, in the Disney universe, it seems that this specific tradition was not carried forward into the culture of the Kingdom of the Sun. But another custom that they had back then may have been. At the beginning of the movie, Cusco enters the room where there's a lineup of eligible bachelorettes for Cusco to choose for a wife. This, of course, he rejects them all to do very vain reasons to kind of be a funny thing. But what if this was a cultural norm for the royal family and their bloodline in this story and in this universe? We also know that Yzma was once revered for being one of the most beautiful women in the entire kingdom and that she had the luxury of growing up very near to the crown. So I think that Yzma was actually chosen as one of these eligible bachelorettes to Cusco's father or grandfather, or who knows, even her great-grandfather, because we don't really know how old she is and they always make fun of her age. Anyway, this theory makes more sense when you consider the following. Yzma was once famed for her beauty and men would fall at her feet. However, we have no records of her actually taking a husband. This could mean she had her sights set high, most likely on the future emperor, who she most likely grew up around and had feelings for. In other words, Yzma was once in love. Pretty cliche, I know, but Disney likes to do these type of things. Anyway, if she was in fact rejected like we saw Cusco do and pushed to the side, perhaps she felt like the role of empress was stolen from her by the woman who did end up marrying the emperor. So that could be part of the motivation behind this. Now, another thing to keep in mind here is that Yzma is considered to be a very talented and noteworthy chemist, alchemist, or even a sorceress, depending on the different versions of the story and how early they are into development before they changed over the script to the Emperor's New Groove. Now, getting back to this, the theory is that Yzma had never known rejection before that moment and sought to create a potion to take away the pain that she had inside of her heart. But, like all of her potions, they never quite work like they're supposed to, whether the effects are totally different than intended, or the effects are only temporary. What if her potion backfired on her and the effects of it, instead of causing her pain to end, it actually amplified her pain, sending her spiraling into a state of madness, or at the very least, creating a monster inside her? But a failed potion and a broken heart doesn't really seem to be enough to create this villainous character, and that's where the rest of this theory comes in. I don't think there is a single mainstream animated Disney movie that does not tie in with another movie in some way, shape, or fashion. We have confirmed things like Scar showing up in Hercules, Carpet showing up in multiple universes, and theories and connections on Rapunzel, Frozen, Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, and Tarzan. Now, all those things tie together, pretty much saying that Disney loves to connect their stories through little Easter eggs, which is awesome. Anyway, so where is the connection with Emperor's New Groove? Now, there are actually two characters from the movie that connect Emperor's New Groove with the movie Hercules. Like I said earlier, a couple of aspects of Hercules that connect Yzma to Emperor's New Groove. Let's start with the obvious. Like I said before, Hades. Going back to the information about the Supai being the ruler of the underworld, it becomes no surprise that the thought of the Supai and Hades being one and the same fits the bill in our case. In the movie and the series of Hercules, Hades utilizes people to do his bidding, granting them wishes if they become his zealots and do his bidding until their debt is repaid. Not to mention he takes ownership over their souls. Now with Yzma being a worshiper of Supai, we can assume the deity that she is worshiping is none other than Hades. But how can we further this connection? Well, again in the movie, Hades pulls out a potion bottle that looks strikingly similar to the potion bottle that Yzma carries in her movie. Also, there's a ride at Disneyland that puts Hades in the Emperor's New Groove universe. It's not officially canon, but you can clearly see that Disney is also aware of the similarities between the two. So what if Yzma was not the one who created the potion in the Emperor's New Groove? Instead, I believe it was actually her father who made the potion and that was used on Cusco. And that was also the same person, her father, who made the mortality potion that Hades used on Hercules all those years before. Now, it seems pretty far-fetched, doesn't it? Until you consider the following evidence. According to the songs Yzma sings, her father was a mortician, meaning he dealt with the dead royal family members of the Incan Empire, who were, according to their ancient lore, considered to be descendants of the sun god, and thus were gods in their own way. Also, he had to have been a magician, and we can assume that her father's motives were to concoct a mortality potion that could work on a god that had been commissioned by Hades for his devious plots. But anyway, guys, I know it kind of got out of hand here and kind of got really long-winded, but I hope you guys all enjoyed. Like I said, it's so much fun to go back and kind of connect the dots with these characters we don't get to know too much about. Disney doesn't put them in the spotlight too often, and it's kind of, I think it's interesting to see what their characters have to offer that we didn't really know about previously and kind of connect some dots ourselves. But anyway, like I said, thank you guys so much for watching. I really appreciate it if you guys hit that like button. If you guys are Disney fans, you guys want to stick around and watch more Disney videos, check out the links in the description and make sure you guys are subscribed and hitting that bell button to get all of my videos in your notifications. Also, remember, guys, if you guys want to hang out with me and talk in my personal Discord, where we talk Disney, we talk theories, we talk all kinds of fun stuff, I'll leave a link to my Discord. We also do voice chats and fun stuff over there. But until next time, guys, remember that it's always K-Mac time somewhere. Until then, take it easy and peace out.